in the corporate laws front, especially in the last 4 to 5 months, especially from 1st January 2021 onwards. When I was having a chat with the speaker, I told him, what are the topics that you would like to cover? Because the topic has been designed as company law changing dynamics. So a lot of changes have taken place. So what are the changes? I asked him, what are the changes that you would like to discuss with the August audience today? So he said that there are a lot of changes that have taken place. Of course, some changes have been deferred by 1 year, but in spite of that, they have started from the 1st of April 2021. So those are also relevant. So he said that I will try to touch upon all the changes that have taken place in the corporate laws front from 1st of January 2021. See, in our study circle, it has always been our endeavor to be very practical oriented. We have to be very practical so that whatever we discuss is of use to the membership at large on a day-to-day basis during their while carrying out their profession. So we felt that the changes that we could be discussing could be the changes in board meeting dates. It could be changes in charge filing. There are certain changes. Then there were changes in merger of startups and startup benefits. Then scrutiny issues of uploaded forms. As you know that previously all forms were through a straight through process, but then at Maneswar, a central scrutiny center was opened up to scrutinize all forms that have been uploaded, because previously these forms were not they were just being uploaded, but there were no questions being asked by the ministry on those forms. So that has come, which is a very important amendment. Then changes in schedule 5 also has come. Schedule 3 also has come, although deferred. And obviously Karo 2020, which kept on being deferred twice, I think, this will be applicable when we do the audit of financial statements for 21-22 financial year, of course. But from 1/4/21, the operation has started actually for Karo. And I would request the speaker to deal upon the changes between Karo 16 and Karo 2020. So there are a lot of changes which has taken place. So to bring all the changes in one capsule, in a 1.5 hour session, I think is the requirement and the need of the hour. So because we keep on getting these changes in various WhatsApp groups, but on a piecemeal basis. So in order to have them together and to have a discussion, I think we'll once again refresh our memory and will also help us to move forward. So with the small introduction of the subject which we will be discussing, if you have any questions, you can put it in the chat box. And I recognize the presence of not only Devan and Shuman, the VCM coordinators, and Devan being the secretary of the ERC. I also recognize the presence of all the delegates who have come from not only from Calcutta, but from Orissa, from Asansol and other places. Because as you know, in a VCM, you can have any delegate from Coimbatore also. So there is no issue. It is a pan-India arrangement, basically. I would also like to acknowledge the presence of Onindo Basu, Devopriya Basu. They both are in the executive committee and the others. So without mincing much words, I hand over to Devan to say a few words and about our forthcoming programs also, which we have planned also in the next week. And then it will be over to Animesh to start his deliberations. It's over to you, Devan.
A very good morning to everyone. The speaker of the day, CA Animesh Mukhopadhyay. A very warm welcome to Animesh Da, the president of the Salt Lake City Chartered Accountants Association, CA Shuman Trugu, and all the other executive committee members and the delegates without whom this program cannot be a success. So good morning and warm welcome to all of you. The topic today, if we go back 8-9 years, and if we had to think of a change in Companies Act, then that was rare, at least in the early days of my articleship and career. I had seen that there was hardly any change in the Companies Act. But once this Companies Act, new Companies Act was brought in, from then, I think this is a really dynamic law. And today we have Animesh da, C. Animesh Mukhopadhyay, to deliberate on the recent changes. I'm sure he will take us through all those important changes which would be relevant in our day-to-day practice. Apart from this, I must also mention that the EIRC has taken a vaccination drive in the month of March and April, and currently another vaccination drive has been taken. So you all must have received the mails. So if you are interested, if you want, please take the benefit of the drive that we have taken. With these words, I don't think there. Coming to the forthcoming programs, as Sumantra sir mentioned, day after tomorrow, 8th of this month, in the evening from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., we have a program on GST where GST departmental audit will be discussed by C. Abhishek Agarwal. And in the next Sunday, 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., we will have a seminar on Code of Ethics where Sumantra sir would be the speaker. And you all also know that this Code of Ethics, 2 hours is a mandatory structured CP that is required, that one has to do as per the ICAI guidelines. So I'm sure that you all would be joining that program. So with these words, I hand over it back to C. Sumantra Guha sir.
Nothing much to add. As we all know that Animesh is a prolific speaker, and he not only deals in corporate laws, he's also an insolvency resolution professional, and he is regularly attending NCLT and handling insolvency cases, and he is in the know of things that is happening on a day-to-day basis,
Hello. Not
on the NCLT front, but also on the corporate laws front. So without wasting much time, now it is 11:15. Animesh, you can take around 1 hour, 15 minutes, 20 minutes, because if there are questions, 1 hour, 20 minutes, say, if there are questions, then we'll take it up in the last 15, 20 minutes and can sum up by 1 o'clock. So although you can speak for 1.5 hours, but if you feel so, if there are a lot of questions, you can curtail it to 1 hour, 15, 20 minutes as well. There is no issue. Huh? So with these words, we start the program. Animesh, it's all yours now.
Thank you, Sumantrada. I believe I am properly audible.
Yes.
Audible. Yes, you are.
Yeah.
Okay. So good morning, everybody. I am particularly thankful to Sumantrada, Devayan, to Suman, for giving this opportunity to make these deliberations. And I'm also thankful to all the organizers of Salt Lake CA Chartered Accountant Study Circle, because it is almost like a homecoming for me. So previously, when I used to have the opportunity of this physical, deliberation, so within the shortest possible notice also, I used to, you know, come down and make the deliberations. But that was a fantastic moment, but I hope that this will also be an enjoyable one. Now, good morning, everybody, particularly about so many participants here. And this is the best thing that in this, VC mode, so at least this virtual interaction is open. So cutting down the introduction part, I'm just entering to the deliberations, because there are varied and diversified areas which I would try to cover. But before starting the deliberations, I offer on behalf of everybody, I offer the homage to all the departed souls, particularly in our profession also, who have lost their lives due to this pandemic. So we are really going through a very difficult time. And We always remember, we will remember the departed souls, their contributions. We have lost our seniors, we have lost our colleagues, our friends, our acquaintances. So it is really a very difficult and disturbing moment for all of us. But we are keeping confidence. We are looking for the, waiting for the light to come again. So with this note, let me start the deliberations. Now, in my deliberations, there are, in fact, in two ways, actually, I have tried to cover this. One is a PPT presentation that I'll take care of later on. And the other part is direct deliberations. So now let me start this thing. Yeah. So this changing dynamics of company law.
Have you shared something?
No, I haven't.
Oh, okay, okay, okay.
I'll do it later on, Devan.
Fine.
Now, in this changed dynamics or changing dynamics of this company law, I have tried to cover the company law part because if we consider the corporate law, then I need to bring the insolvency matters also here, particularly the prepackaged insolvency process. But I am not covering that this due to time constraints. Now, to start with, an important dichotomy appears to me. This is something which I must share, I thought. You know, the GDP has come down and plummeted to the unprecedented level of negative 7.3%. Everywhere the joblessness is there, people are losing jobs, and the entire economy is gasping. And that too has happened definitely due to this pandemic. This is one story. But surprisingly, the other part is, compared to 2019-20, in 2021, 1.55 lakhs of companies have been incorporated. So it is more, last year in 2019-20, it was 1.22 lakhs. So the direct growth of 27%. In April only, about 12,554 companies have been created. And you know, from Maharashtra, the largest number of companies have been created. It is about 2292. So, in fact, your LLP, that has also gone up to 17% from 36,176 in 2019-20. To 42,186 in 2020-21. So this dichotomy really indicates that creation of company is not the major source of improving the economy. Again, the social scientists will take care of all these things. Economists will take care of these things. But this is surprising. It might be due to ease of doing business, for which the company creation is a much easier options. But I feel there are other aspects also. The bigger houses might be asking the smaller houses for getting the company registration first, so that at least for any non-compliance, the bigger houses can go to insolvency court, because if you want to bring the other party to insolvency, then both of them should be companies. So it might be that the bigger houses are trying to, you know, keep this options open. And at the same time, husband, wife, or two friends, they are creating companies, particularly by taking the advantage of this ease of doing business, because now company creation is easy. And moreover, the minimum capital clause is no longer there. Now, as we know that this MCA site, this site has gone a visible change recently. So now version 3.0, we will notice, where actually at the back end, mostly the tabs are almost in the or the options are almost in the same places, but the front end tabs are little bit, they have been changed. So please go through that and get acquainted with that. What is important is this MCA is now in the process, as Sumantrada has mentioned earlier, is in the process of setting up the central scrutiny cell, which will scrutinize the forms that actually used to be approved under straight through process. And not only that, the scrutiny and along with the flagging of these your irregularities, and finally questions will be raised, deviations will need to be, it needs to be answered by the professionals, and finally disciplinary actions will take place, for which the jurisdictional ROC will be complained. So these things are in the coming. These things are going to be there. Be very cautious about this. Apart from e-scrutiny area, the e-adjudication area is there. We all have come to know this, particularly during this pandemic, that all these courts are mostly running, even from starting from our honorable highest apex court, the Supreme Court, from there to your NCLT and even RD hearings, everything is now in the online mode. And now this is a new normal. So this will be, more entertained and more e-adjudications will be there. And it will particularly facilitate the end-to-end digitization of the process of this adjudication for the ease of doing business again. Because what we have seen, like earlier days, for a half an hour hearing at NCLAT, we used to travel, we used to spend about 2 days. So, and staying at the hotel and finally appearing in the hearing, and that too for only half an hour. But now we can hire the best professional out there, and he can attend your hearing here only. And the cost also has come down. So e-adjudication is really, really helpful for us, for the professionals. E-consultations, to automate and enhance the current process of this public consultations on proposed amendments, there will be an online platform where proposed amendments or this legislations will be posted. So this is again another area that has been covered under this version 3.0. Compliance management system also has been there. And then MCA lab option is there, where actually it will be consisting of the corporate law experts. The primary function of this lab is to evaluate the effectiveness of the CMS. Any consultation model, enforcement models, all these things there. Now the central scrutiny cell, this is something, awe-inspiring. This is something which is really, taking us into a cautious mode. And this will function under the administrative control of the e-governance cell. The main idea behind this is to scrutinize certain STP forms. And this will finally, the intention of MCA is to promote the transparency, the professional skepticism, the red flag, and instances of fraud, and finally the disciplinary actions. Generally, what we find, like your AOC4, XBRL, AOC4, others, then your AOC4 CFS, MGT7, DIR3 KYC, MGT14, DIR12. So all these forms are through STP mode. And previously we used to be very happy, but be very cautious now, because there is a chance. And now how this will be finally selected, That again needs to be determined gradually. And this entire process that I have mentioned will be finally over by October 2021. That's the intention of the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. Now, yeah, so coming back to the other areas where we have noticed the changes, which are important and relevant for our everyday operations and everyday usage. See, actually, in our considering the practical aspects, this, although it is something which, needs to be accepted in a right spirit, actually, that apart from the, in particularly in case of MSMEs, because MSMEs, number of MSMEs are much larger in context to large companies, in comparison to large companies. So in case of MSMEs, what we find generally, but that is again, I should not be quoted anywhere, that's not the right practice. But what happens that the chartered accountant is consulted for starting from the accounting aspects to your company law aspects. Now, this is something which really is not, it should not happen, but it happens. It happens because of the fact that these MSMEs are mostly, getting operated by one single individual, and he is the main person. So there are plenty of things which actually now needs to be taken care of by these MSMEs, which is pretty difficult for them also, I must say, because after going through this, all these changes, and particularly the Schedule 3, the CARO, the non-compliance, and naturally now in today's scenario, the auditor can't afford to go for any sort of deviations, any sort of non-compliance on their part. Because you have seen that STP mode will even be checked. And not only that, there are plenty of other measures which might be taken against the professionals. Now, here in this change about board meeting, section 173, this is something, a straight change which has been done, where the period has been now extended. Previously, what was there? It was 120 days between two board meeting. Now it is actually the gap between two consecutive meeting of the board may extend to 180 days during the quarter, April to June 21, and second quarter, that is July to September 21. This is as per your circular number 08-2021, dated 3rd of May 2021. So now it has been extended to 180 days. Next is relaxations on the levy of additional fees in filing certain forms. This is again, this is issued on 3rd of May, and the circular number is 6-06-2021. Here, it has been stated that particularly for forms during 1st April 2021, whose filing date falls between 1st April 2021 and 31st May 2021, that actually no additional fees, all the additional fees are waived. This will be levied, or this will be extended till 31st of July 2021. But here, your CAG-1, CAG-4, and CAG-9 are not there. Apart from that, because for them, a separate notification has come up. Next is Right. Another very important change which has come up in creation of your MGT7 and MGT7A annual return. Now, in case of annual return, previously we had the form that is known as MGT7. And in this MGT7, we used to attach the director's report separately. If you consider that, used to carry the MGT9 part. MGT9 is nothing but the backup of MGT7, where the details about plenty of things to prepare that MGT7 used to be reflected there. Now, after this amendment, MGT9 is completely dispensed with. There is no scope of MGT9. A separate form, that is abridged annual statement, that is the form of MGT7A. This has been brought into existence for OPCs, one-person company, and your small companies. For others, still that MGT7 will continue. And in this matter, it has also been stated, that your MGT, sorry, yeah. So your MGT7 shall mention the link in the director's report where this, your details will be specified, where you can get the extract or you can get the details of this MGT9. That is the scope now. So once this has been stated, nowhere it has been mentioned about attaching this document with the director's report. So now this MGT9 is completely dispensed with. It can be kept in that particular link in the website. Now the question comes, companies where who's not having the website, but nothing has been stated there. So you can take the advantage of the present amendment where this MGT9, you can all completely, you can avoid this. Yeah. Next is, another important feature that has come up in MGT7A, previously what we used to do in case of your MGT7 or in case of certifying the MGT7, there the practicing company secretary used to sign. If it is not a small company, then the practicing company secretary used to authenticate that. But now in case of MGT7A, where OPCs and small companies are there, this has been, no signature of the professional is required. Next is, Now, this is about the merger of startup companies. This is something also, in today's scenario, we are finding plenty of startups, particularly startups enjoying certain income tax benefits also. I'm just going into the details of how it is going to happen. This is called as Companies Compromise Arrangements and Amalgamation Amendment Rules. here, under section 233, if you recall 233, there actually the scheme of arrangement is prepared. There, it can be done between two or more startup companies or one or more startup company with another small company. Now, what is a startup company? This is also directly, because I have just tried to cover this, although this is not directly related to Companies Act, but this is something which is a separate press statement is there, separate circular notification is there by Government of India, Department for Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade. Just a quick recapitulation of what exactly the startup means to us. Entity shall be considered a startup up to a period of 10 years from the date of incorporation, registration, if it is incorporated as a private limited company or partnership firm, a registered partnership firm or LLP. So proprietorship cannot function as a startup. Turnover of the company or of the entity rather for any of the financial years since incorporation has not exceeded 100 crore. Entities working towards innovation, development, or improvement of products or process or services. And also, it can work in the scalable business models with a high potential of employment generations or wealth creation. So all these will be covered under the startups. A startup cannot be, you know, considered a startup by splitting up the reconstructed existing business. So there are plenty of benefits that the company, once a company becomes or an entity becomes a startup, it might enjoy various benefits under Income Tax Act. I'm not going into those details, but this is definitely a major area for, particularly for our professional practice, because many of the technocrats, many of the young entrepreneurs, they are going into, you know, opening up of this startup. So help them, guide them in this particular area. And also a lot of mergers are also, the amalgamations, the mergers are taking place. So this is about the startup thing that has come up. Then, this incorporation I'm just avoiding. Another area is, in case of, this is about on 25th January, it has come up. This is relating to GSR 44E. This is a conversion of the private company to public company. There also, if any objections comes up, received by the regional director, any specific objections. So now, previously this was not there. It has been included now, that for any objections, the application with a specific objection, the same shall be recorded in writing and the regional director shall hold a hearing within a period of 30 days as required and direct the company to file an affidavit. And finally, upon hearing, the regional director shall pass the order either approving or rejecting the applications. If there is no consensus is received, then the regional director may approve the conversion if he is satisfied, having regard to all the circumstances of the case. Now in Schedule 5, this is important additions. 18th March 2021, this has come up as per SO1256, Schedule 5. Now, Schedule 5 talks about the managerial remuneration part. In particularly in part 2, there, what we find that the managerial persons or persons, here the words director or directors have been included. Now, there is a very important aspect about it. After this amendment, the independent directors and the non-executive directors, for the first time, the remuneration part is quantified here. It has been stated, but the previous portions, that is for the managerial persons, the managerial remuneration part, this is completely as it was before. Let me just mention you, then you'll understand. Where the effective capital is negative or less than 5 crore, your limit of yearly remuneration is about, shall not exceed 60 lakhs. Limit of yearly remuneration payable in case of other directors, that will be now 12 lakhs. Now, one important thing which we often come across, that what would be the remunerations for director in a private limited company? Is there any maximum limit? No, there is no limit for maximum limit for directors in case of a private limited company, because this, all these things, these changes, this Schedule 5 and this change is related to your Section 197. And Section 197 is actually the total managerial remuneration payable by a public company. In the very first line, it has been mentioned. So this is entirely on the, this is entirely the considerations or the remuneration that will be paid to the directors of the public company. Now, one important aspect is a managerial person. Now, if you consider the definition of key managerial personnel, that is Section 2, Subsection 51. Key managerial personnel, there actually you will find that he is a CEO, he is a company secretary, he is a whole-time director, and he is a CFO, and the manager or such other officers, not more than one level below the directors who is in the whole-time employment. So, considering this aspect, a non-executive director is not falling within the purview of managerial personnel. So there actually, the salary has been now fixed. That is 12 lakhs. That is a maximum. In case negative or less than 5 crore of effective capital. 5 crore and above, but up to 100 crore, it is 17. Then 100 crore to 250 crore, up to 250 crore, it is 24 lakhs. And 250 crores and above, it is 24 lakhs plus 0.01% of the effective capital in excess of 250 crores. So this is the calculation, or this is the benchmark that has been set now clearly in the schedule. So this is about an area that will finally, you know, clear many of the disputes. Now, coming back to some other changes. General Circular Number 07-2021, that is again 3rd of May 2021. There the changes of charge filing is now covered. What has been stated there? It has been stated there actually two differentiations are done. In case where the creation or the modification was due before 1/4/2021, but the timeline for filing such form had not expired under Section 77 as on 1st of April 2021. This is number one. And for the cases which are falling between 1/4/2021 and 31st of May 2021. Now, presently, in case of charge filing, we know that the total timeline is about 120 days. Now, in case of a form is filed in respect of the first instance, that is where the charge was created before 1/4/2021, then what actually the concept here, this concept we are also finding in all other laws, in IBC also, we are finding this, that is called the exclusion time. Due to pandemic, what they have done, that this period from 1st April 2021 to 31st May of 2021, this will be considered as a exclusion period. So whatever days that needs to be added, that will be added from 1st June onwards. So accordingly, the period will be reckoned. Accordingly, the period will be counted. Both in case of if it has been previously done before 1st of April, then the date, if it is falling between this from 1st April to 31st May, that period will be finally considered off from 1st of June onwards. And if in case it is a case where second option is there, then the date will be on 1st June onwards. So this is a clear change that has been there. Okay. Right. Now, there are plenty of changes that have been, I mean, that have been covered in this CSR issues. Although, as we know, that the CSR is for applicable for mostly for large companies, where the net worth is about 5 crore, or the turnover is 1,000 crore, or your net profit is about 5 crore. So here we are finding a lot of changes that has been taken place. Now, right. Now for this, company's CSR amendment rule 2021 is now effective. And there, important changes, like any company engaged in the research and development activity of new vaccine, drugs, and medical devices in their normal course of business, that has been considered. For COVID vaccine. And for the financial years 2021, 21-22, 22-23. Provided such research and development activities shall be carried out in collaboration with the institutes as mentioned in Schedule 7, and details of such activity shall be disclosed separately in the annual report on CSR, included in the board's report. I'm just mentioning the salient points. Ongoing project. This is again an important concept that has been taken care of. Means this is a multi-year project undertaken by the company for this meeting the CSR obligations, having the timeline not exceeding 3 years. Excluding the financial year in which it has been commenced. And it shall include such project that was initially not approved as a multi-year project, but whose duration has been extended beyond 1 year by the board based on reasonable justification. This will be also considered as ongoing project. The board shall ensure ensure that the CSR activities, they are undertaken by the company itself or through a company established under Section 8 or a registered public trust or registered society established by the company either singly or along with any other company, or a company established under Section 8 or a registered trust or society established by the central government or state government, etc. Now, important area. Every entity who intends to undertake any CSR activity shall register itself with the central government, for which a separate facility is provided in the portal. Along with that, all the non-governmental organizations, the NGOs, you might be handling a couple of or plenty of NGOs where actually you will find that they're asking for registration to be done, because for any CSR fund that needs to be availed by these NGOs, they should be also registered in this portal. CSR one form needs to go to MCA. So, and for which actually a practicing chartered accountant or a practicing company secretary needs to authenticate the form. So this has now been, this is a change that has been brought in now. In rule 5.2, that is a substitution has taken place. The CSR committee shall formulate and recommend to the board an annual action plan in pursuance of its CSR policy, which shall include the CSR projects and programs. So it is actually the CSR committee shall formulate. Previously, if you look back, it was not like this. So it was like, if you just consider 5.2, the CSR committee shall institute a transparent monitoring mechanism and for implementation of the CSR project. Now it is the CSR committee shall formulate and recommend the board an annual action plan. Then CSR expenditure. The board shall ensure that the administrative overheads shall not exceed 5% of the total CSR expenditure of the company for the financial year. Identical to this, there is another change that has come in FCRA. If you handle FCRA, there you must have noticed that with effect from 1st of October, by virtue of the amendment on 30th of September 2020, this change has come in FCRA also, where the admin expense cannot go beyond 20%. Here it is 5%.
ওই সাইটে আরেকটা সেমিনার অ্যাটেন্ড করছি, সেমিনার অ্যাটেন্ড করছি বলে সাউন্ড পেতে পারি স্যার কি জাগে কি খবর এমনি? হ্যালো,
এই দেবান একটু সবাইকে মিউট করিয়ে দাও, তারপর আনমিউট করো প্লিজ।
সো So now, this shall not exceed 5% of the total CSR expenditure in a financial year. So all these points, mind it, these are so very essential that this will come to your reporting also. We'll discuss about these issues also. Now, any surplus arising out of the CSR activities shall not form part of the business profit of a company and shall be plowed back into the same project or shall be transferred to unspent CSR account and spent in pursuance of the CSR policy. There should be an unspent CSR account in the bank, in the designated bank. Now, where a company spends an amount in excess of the requirement provided under Section 135(5), such excess, that is 2%, such excess amount may be set off against the requirement to spend under Section 135(5) up to immediate succeeding 3 financial years. So you can set off, you can square off the excess spending. Subject to the condition that the excess amount available for set off shall not include the surplus arising out of the CSR activities, and the board of the company shall pass a resolution to that effect. The CSR amount may be spent by the company for creation or acquisition of the capital asset. This capital asset can be used, can be held by the company established under section, by a company under established under section 8, that is non-profit making, or any trust or registered society, and beneficiary of the said project or the self-help group or a public authority. Provided any capital asset created by the company before the prior to the commencement of this amendment within period of 180 days, which may extend to another 90 days, it needs to be done. Board's report of the company shall include the annual report on this CSR, and in case of a foreign company, the balance sheet filed under Section 381 shall contain an annual report on this CSR containing the particulars specified in Annexure 1 to Annexure 2 as applicable. So that also needs to be there. So this is a change of the CSR. Another important change about the CSR is also I just want to touch upon. That is the excess CSR funds. There is one circular that came on 20th of May. Actually, during the time of pandemic, when it got started in the month of March last year, that time, government actually requested the MDs and the CEOs of around 1,000 companies, top blue chip 1,000 companies, in terms of the market capitalization, the largest this 1,000 companies, to contribute generously into this PM CARE fund. And it was also mentioned that such contribution include the unspent CSR account amount, if any, and an amount over and above the minimum CSR amount that these companies were supposed to contribute in the year 2019-20, which can later on be offset against the CSR obligation in the subsequent financial years. Finally, on the basis of this, corporates contributed generously, but now the appeal has come to PM CARES Fund and also to the ministry that this, what would be done for this excess payments that has been done. So this issue has been now considered, and over and above, particularly the minimum amount that has been paid and the excess amount that has been paid. So that will be adjusted, that will be offset as such unspent amount. And the CFO shall certify that the contribution to PM CARES Fund was indeed made on 31st March 2020 in pursuance of the appeal, and the details of such contribution shall be disclosed separately in the annual report on CSR as well as in the board's report. So this is now stated in this particular circular. Now, let us move to the very important area that is the Schedule 3 changes. So let me share the screen, Devan.
Want to be enable kore diyecho screen sharing?
Kora ache? এটা কি দেখা যাচ্ছে? Is it okay? Can you see this?
স্লাইড শোটা শুরু করো আর তোমাকে নিজেকে না তুমি ইয়ে করে তুমি তোমার ভিডিওটা স্টপ করে দিতে পারো অনিমেষ দা
আচ্ছা ওকে ইজ ইট ওকে নাও
হ্যাঁ এবার তুমি স্লাইড শোটা চালু করো
অনিমেষ দা ফার্স্ট ইউ হ্যাভ টু স্টপ দি স্ক্রিন শেয়ারিং এন্ড দেন ইউ হ্যাভ টু select okay. the PPT in the screen sharing. On oile oi folder tai dekhiye jao.
Okay. So first ami ki share korbo bolcho.
Stop screen sharing. Stop screen sharing first.
Okay. Okay.
Actually in Zoom, whatever screen you share, only that screen can be seen. So we are not seeing the PPT. We are seeing the folder where the PPT was.
Okay. Okay. Just a এবার আমি তো স্টপ করে দিয়েছি
হ্যাঁ এবার তুমি স্ক্রিন নাও ইউ ক্যান গো টু দি স্ক্রিন শেয়ারিং অপশন এন্ড সিলেক্ট দি পিপিটি ইটসেলফ
ওকে এক মিনিট হ্যাঁ দেবান
ইয়েস ইয়েস প্লিজ
রাইট তাও কি এটা এসে যাচ্ছে
না ফোল্ডারটাই আসছে
ফোল্ডারটা আসছে না ওইটা বারবার এটা হয়ে যাচ্ছে
তুমি পিপিটি আলাদা জায়গা নিয়ে তারপরে স্ক্রিন শেয়ারিং এর সময় পিপিটিটাই সিলেক্ট করো
ঠিক আছে জাস্ট ওয়ান মিনিট এবার বোধ হয় আসবে হ্যাঁ এবার আমি এটাকে ইয়েতে মেনি ইজ ইট ওকে নাও
হ্যাঁ ইটস ওকে
রাইট
We have seen the disclaimer.
Right. So this changes in Schedule 3 and CARO, these are the two very important topic in today's deliberations. On 24th of March, this circular, this notification regarding this your changes in the Schedule 3, amendment of Schedule 3 and accounting rules, this has come up, 205 GSR 205E. Now, along with this, there is also the CARO part. One very important aspect in CARO that I'll be, once I complete Schedule 3, I'll come to CARO, particularly about the date of implementation of CARO. That is, I'll discuss. Okay, let me just start, because this is again a long thing to discuss. Now this Schedule 3, this actually is covering, and this is now effective from 1st April 2021. So for the accounts of 21-22, these changes will be there, except in one particular change that will be, we will consider. This is in general instruction for the word turnover, total income will be there, the word. Then your property, plant and equipment. In CARO also, we will find that fixed assets is an obsolete term now. So it is property, plant and equipment. And as we know, that there are three divisions, Division 1, Division 2, and Division 3. Division 1, where the accounting standard rules, that is applicable, that Division 2, companies where Ind AS is applicable, and Division 3 consists of your NBFCs. Now, apart from property, plant, and equipment, that is a tangible assets, the intangible assets shall be inserted along with this property, plant, and equipment. Then your, for the financial year commencing on or after 1/4/21, every company which uses accounting software for maintaining its books of accounts shall use only such accounting software which has a feature of recording the audit trail. This is a really, really painful thing. And initially, this circular, I mean, this notification came only on 24th of March, and it became effective from 1st of April. This is a complete blow, particularly for the MSMEs. Be very cautious about this thing, this change. Try to understand the intention of the authority, the regulators. Now, in five, your company accounts, company's account rules, 2014, there in rule 3.1, it has been stated that the books of accounts and other relevant books and papers maintained in electronic mode shall remain accessible in India so as to be usable for subsequent references. Now it has been there that every company, so there is no threshold limit, nothing. Every company which uses accounting software, mostly all the companies are now under, they use accounting software. So for maintaining its books of accounts, it shall use only such accounting software which has a feature of recording the audit trail for each and every transactions. So this was a real blow, and particularly for MSMEs, they are so unorganized. At times, they even maintain in Excel, although that is not allowed. That is not, absolutely not allowed. But this happens. So you need to have like ZohoBooks, like QuickBooks. I believe that in Tally software, there is one Prime. Tally Prime is there, where actually you can keep this, trail, audit trail. So that needs to be there for every transaction. Finally, this actually created a lot of hue and cry. So now this has been deferred. This particular change, but not the entire changes, this particular change has been deferred till next year. But keep yourself prepared that this thing is really going to challenge everybody, the companies, and as well as, and how much and how far the companies will be able to maintain all these logs, and what would be, because this is something which is again a matter of concern, and again an addition of cost because of changing of the software's platform. So these will be there, but again a change, and that has been duly approved, so we have to accept it. But this will be effective from next year. Yes, this is 247E. This has confirmed this thing. First day of April 22 is substituted now. Now in Rule 8, where the board's report, matters to be included in the board's report, there, after clause 10, so after clause 10, the following clauses shall be inserted, that the details of the application made or any proceedings under IBC during the year, along with their status as at the end of the financial year, that needs to be mentioned. So this position again will be reflected in other places also, we'll be coming to that. And the details of the difference between amount of the valuation done at the time of one-time settlement and the valuation done while taking loan from the banks or financial institutions, along with the reasons thereof. This is something terrible. If the company has availed any OTS, and there the valuation at the time of availing the OTS, that needs to be compared, and that needs to be compared with the initial valuation that was made when the loan was availed. If there is any degradation, that needs to be reflected, the reasons needs to be stated. This is a board report content. Now, audit trail is the sequential, step-by-step sequential record. So every day, this means once this audit trail matter has come up, we can have a more detailed discussion on this on some other day. But this is something which is really going to otherwise make easier our life, particularly when we are going to sign the audit report, we are going to attest the audit report. Our attest function will be more onerous in that way. But at the same time, this requires a persistent and everyday effort on the part of the company, proper system support, a proper person to handle the matters. So all this, and finally, everything comes with a cost. So this will finally add up cost. Rule 11D is no longer there in this board's report, where the company had provided requisite disclosures, that is in the specified SBN, specified bank notes. No, that has been now deleted. And there, new inclusion, 11E and 11F and G. 11E talks about whether the management has represented to the best of its knowledge and belief, other than as disclosed in the notes and accounts, no funds have been advanced. So this is something, a conduit. This is something, a hidden arrangement. This is something, an intermediary. You see this, with the understanding, whether recorded in writing or otherwise, that the intermediary shall directly, indirectly lend or invest in other persons or entities identified in any manner whatsoever by or on behalf of the company, or provide any guarantee, security, or the like. So this needs to be reflected under Rule 11E. Again, whether the management has represented that to the best of his knowledge and belief, other than as disclosed in the notes and accounts, no fund have been received. There the no fund has been paid, now it has been received by the company. Again, there's a whether there is any scope of intermediary, the conduit arrangement is there. So that needs to be reflected. Based on such audit procedures that the auditor has considered reasonable and appropriate in the circumstances, nothing has come to the notice that has caused them to believe that the representations under subclause 1 and 2 contain any material misstatement. Material misstatement means around 10% deviations. So you see the position of the auditor. Whether the dividend declared or paid during the year by the company is in compliance to 123 of the Companies Act. Whether the company has used such accounting software, again, this has been mentioned in the board's report. Initially, it was under Rule 3. Now, in this 11G, it has been mentioned also that the accounting software is maintained and which is a feature of logging facilities. And the same has been operated throughout the year for all transactions recorded in the software and has not been tampered. So you need to, but at the same time, as an auditor, you need to check this trail. You have to check this trail. And the audit trail has been preserved by the company as per the statutory requirements for record retention. Now, these are the rounding offs. It's not so important. Additional disclosures in notes to balance sheet, shareholding of the promoter. Previously, it was only 5% promoter's shareholding. But now, for all classes of promoters, it needs to be reflected. The note on share capital in the financial statement shall mention all these things. That is, shares held by the promoters at the end of the year, percentage change during the year. Here, serial number, the promoter's name, the number of shares, percentage of shares change, everybody, for all the promoters. Now, after that, there is another very, very important and pertinent change. Trade payables with aging schedule, that needs to be reflected in the notes. That aging schedule for trade payables due to the periodicity of 1 year, 1 to 2 years, 2 to 3 years, more than 3 years. And there, specifically, like in this way, it needs to be mentioned. You see, MSME, others, disputed dues to MSMEs, disputed dues to others. So you need to have the breakup. You need to reflect this. Similarly, trade receivables like the debtors, that also needs to be disclosed in the same line as we have noticed in case of trade creditors. This is a way that we need to disclose this. Title deeds. Now this title deeds and revaluation of assets, these will be again covered in the CARU also. So title deeds of immovable property not held in the name of the company, that is the Benami transactions. The company shall provide the details of the immovable property other than the properties where the company is the lessee or the lease agreements are duly executed in favor of the lessee, whose title deeds are not held in the name of the company. If such immovable property is jointly held with others, all the information pertaining to that needs to be reflected. Revaluation of assets. Revaluation of assets is where the company has revalued its property, plant or equipment. The company shall disclose as to whether the revaluation is based on the valuation done by the registered valuer. Registered valuer, please be cautious, this registered valuer means a valuer of who is having the qualification as per Insolvency Bankruptcy Board of India. reconciliation of the gross and net carrying amount of each class of asset at the beginning and at the end of the reporting period, showing additions, disposals, acquisitions through business combinations, if all these things would be reflected if the change is 10% or more. Intangible assets. Under this intangible assets, reconciliation of the gross and net carrying amount. Same thing that also needs to be done for intangible ones. Capital WIP for following aging schedule shall be given. Aging schedule what? Like capital work in progress. Again, that less than 1 year, 1 to 2 years, 2 to 3 years, more than 3 years. Project in progress and project temporarily suspended. Total shall tally with the capital WIP in the balance sheet. Now for capital WIP whose completion is overdue or has exceeded its cost, a separate disclosure on year-wise breakup shall be made. Disclosures on loans and advances to related parties, to directors, to KMPs, it shall be made where loans and advances either severally or jointly with any other person that are repayable on demand or without specifying any terms or period of payment. In addition to related party, this is again a duplication of work because we are otherwise reflecting this in the related party disclosure part. But in addition to this, you need to reflect this in the notes to accounts. Like this way, it needs to be mentioned. Type of the borrower, promoter, directors, KMPs, related parties, and loan advanced, as outstanding loan, and percentage to the total loans and advances in the nature of loans. Details of Benami properties. If proceedings have been initiated, the corresponding disclosures. What would be the disclosures? Entire details. Details of the beneficiaries, the properties in the books, and reference to the item in the balance sheet. If property is not reflected in the books, then the fact that it has not been stated, why it was not being reflected. If the company is under this law is an abettor of the transaction, that needs to be provided. What the proceedings are, in which stage, that needs to be provided, everything. It is almost like when I have gone through these changes, I found that it is almost like a management report. Because always the audit reports are more, you know, focused, crisp, and what actually the stakeholders want. But here certain elaborate reflections, again, that time will say how this will be beneficial and how far it is going to, you know, finally affecting our area of operation. Now, details of borrowing, where the company has borrowings from banks or financial institutions, where the quarterly returns or statements of current assets filed by the company with banks or financial institutions are in agreement with the books of accounts, if not a summary of reconciliation. You see, this is something which is very important. Where the company has borrowings from the bank or financial institutions, it shall disclose whether quarterly returns or statements, like the stock statement, of current assets filed by the company, they are agreement with the books of accounts. So, to avail the DP, changing of the stocks and changing of the debtors, so that needs to be exactly matched. And you will be having mandate, you will be having the audit trail. So the auditor has the responsibility to check. Finally, when he will be checking the accounts and the transaction logs, there can be a checking area. If not a summary of reconciliations and reasons for material discrepancies, funds borrowed for a specific purpose and has not been used, that needs to be disclosed. Willful defaulter, where a company is declared as a willful defaulter by the bank, the entire details, date of declaration. Willful defaulter means the willful defaulter. I have just covered this thing. This is RBI circular, master circular, where it has been clearly mentioned the areas, I mean, when this willful defaulter tag comes to the company, deliberate non-payment of the dues. What we find in case of IBC is mostly under Section 7 of the IBC, all these defaulting cases, they're mostly willful defaulters, we find. But at that point of time, the law was not in that way stringent that we are finding now. So many of the cases, many of the companies, many of the erring corporates, they are actually not coming within the purview of willful default. So deliberate non-payment of the dues, siphoning of funds to the detriment of the defaulting unit, assets finance either not been purchased or been sold, have misutilized and misrepresentations or falsification of records, disposals and fraudulent transactions. Relationship with the struck-off companies. Struck-off companies means 248, where non-filing of the financial statements for which the company has been struck down. So where the company has any transactions with the struck-off companies, with a struck-off unit, the company shall disclose the name of the, because at times what we find that a company has paid the loan, paid the advance, or has done a business. This is a very common thing in previous days. Company used to have a lot of businesses with unknown, you know, units or something, you know, not so widely known, or else Ayaram Gayaram case, and creation used to happen. Creation of these companies. And finally, these companies used to take large advances from these erring companies. And finally, they did not file the returns because non-existent. So nature of transactions with the struck-off companies, that needs to be specified, balance outstanding, and relationship with the struck-off company. Whether any related party is there or not, all these things should be mentioned. Registration of charges, where any charge or satisfaction yet to be registered beyond the statutory period, details and reasons thereof shall be disclosed. Compliance with the number of layers of companies. Two layers are allowed, maximum. So where the company has not complied with the number of layers prescribed under Section 287, then the name and the sin of the companies needs to be beyond the specified layers, that needs to be reflected in the downstream companies. Yes, this is a company restriction of number of layers rules, where no company shall have more than two layers of subsidiaries, provided that the provision of this sub-rule shall not affect a company from acquiring a company incorporated outside India with subsidiaries beyond two layers. Disclosure of ratios. Various accounting ratios, current ratio, debt equity ratio, debt service coverage ratio. So your project preparation job will be much easier. So everything will be reflected now. Return on equity ratio, inventory turnover ratios. So all these ratios will be reflected. And for both Division 1 and Division 2 and Division T, Division 1 and Division 2 companies. The company shall explain the items included in the numerator and denominator for computing the above ratios, and an explanation for variation more than 25%. That needs to be in the preceding year. That needs to be also explained why this deviation. In addition, NBFCs, that is a Division 3 companies, they also need to disclose this capital to risk-weighted average assets ratio, Tier 1 CRAR, Tier 2, and liquidity coverage ratios. But these are already getting disclosed by NBFCs. Details in respect of utilization of the borrowed funds and share premium, where the entity has provided any advance, any loans, or invested funds to any other person, including foreign entities. transactions where an entity has received any fund similarly from or any from any entity or including the foreign entities. In the profit and loss account part, this is again a very important addition. The company shall give the details of the transactions not recorded in the books for which any surrender or any disclosure has taken place, like Vivad Se Vishwas scheme. Everybody has enjoyed, I mean, whoever has enjoyed, not everybody. So this immunity for disclosure under any scheme, and also shall state whether the previously unrecorded income and related assets have been properly recorded in the books. That addition needs to be properly recorded. CSR disclosure that we have already discussed previously. So I'm just skipping off due to shortage of time. We need to cover the CARO part also. Yes, this is the one of the most happening areas now. Details of the cryptocurrencies or the virtual currencies, any handling the company has done, has traded or invested in the cryptocurrencies, that needs to be, and also the profit or loss on the transactions that took place in this cryptocurrency part, amount of currencies held at the reporting date, deposits or advances from any persons for the purpose of trading or investing in cryptocurrency. So all these things should be disclosed in the your cryptocurrency part. So this is the one that, just a minute. Yeah. So this is your Schedule 3 changes in short, very short, that I have tried to cover. Right. Now, let me quickly go to the CARO part. CARO, I'm not going to share the screen. Let us just start the CARO part quickly, and then we'll come back to, because there are again plenty of changes in the CARO also. Now, in case of CARO, this is one very important thing, that initially the circular GSR 206 E that came on 1/4/2021. That 24th, sorry, this happened in 24th of March 2021, where it was mentioned that the new CARO would be applied from 1/4/21. But on 1/4/21, that GSR 248, that has again come, where the CARO, the new CARO 2020, would be applicable from next year. So that means your 22-23 would be covered by this new CARO 2020. It has also been deferred for 1 year, like your audit trail software. Now, in case of CARO, there are plenty of changes, and I believe that these changes are mostly covered by Schedule 3 also. Now, first, let us come to this thing that this order is not applicable for, this is not, this is right. This is applicable for all companies, including a foreign company, but not applicable for banking company, for insurance companies, for OPCs, and for Section 8, and for private limited companies, not being a subsidiary or holding company of a public company, having a paid up capital in reserves and surplus not more than 1 crore, as on the balance sheet date, not having the total borrowing of 1 crore from any bank or financial institutions at any point of time during the year, and not having a total revenue exceeding 10 crore. Now, one very important change that I need to mention here, there is a very significant amendment that has been done in the definition of a small company. I'll just touch upon that little later. only thing is that now the definition of small company means 2 crore or 20 crore. That means 2 crore of your capital, paid up capital, or 20 crore of your turnover. Anyone, if that is being hit, then the company cannot enjoy the, beyond that, if it goes beyond that, any one criteria, the company will lose the small company status. That is to subsection 85. But now, this is something which is a little bit of, you know, creates a little confusion, that private limited company not being subsidiary, that is okay, having a paid up capital in reserves and surplus, not more than 1 crore. This was a definition earlier available for small companies. Anyways, so now maintenance of records of the... Yeah. So, maintenance of records of the property, plant and equipment. Here, previously, first thing is that there was only fixed assets. Here now it is property, plant and equipment that we have already seen when we discussed Schedule 3 changes. Whether the title deeds of all the immovable properties that we have already covered, disclosed in the financial statements, are held in the name of the company. So all these disclosures, that's what actually I was trying to mention, that these things are already again covered in CARO, means it is clearly, specifically in a earmarked way, the responsibility goes to the auditor also jointly to check all these things. That is the description of the property, the gross value, the held in the name of whom, whether promoter, director, or the relative or employee, period held, and the reason for not being held in the name of the company. All these things needs to be reported, needs to be checked. Then the revaluation part, what we have learned already, that revaluation covered in the Schedule 3 part. Here also, you need to make a comment on this. Specify the amount of the change in the revaluation if it is more than 10%. And whether any proceedings have been initiated or are pending against the company for holding any Benami property. Any Benami property. That needs to be again reflected, and that needs to be commented upon. Then physical verification of inventory. Now, in case of physical verification, previously it was mentioned whether physical verification of the inventories has been conducted at reasonable intervals by the management, and whether any material discrepancies were noticed. And if so, they have been properly, whether they have been properly dealt with. Now you see what has happened. Here, whether in the opinion of the auditor, the coverage and the procedure of such verification by the management is appropriate or not. The coverage and procedure, that needs to be checked. And whether any discrepancies of more than 10%, for each class of inventory, what is this class of inventory? That will differ from company to company. 10% is a constraint. It might be a constraint, the variation. So 10% or more in the aggregate for each class of inventory were noticed, and if so, whether they have been properly dealt with in the books of accounts. That needs to be mentioned by the auditor. That needs to be reported upon. Whether during any point of time, the company has been sanctioned working capital, you look the language, in excess of 5 crores of rupees in aggregate from banks or financial institutions. So not individual bank wise, in aggregate, whether the quarterly returns or statements filed by the company with the such banks or financial institutions are in agreement with the books of accounts, and if not, give the details. So you need to check all the stock statements, all the differences. You need to check from the previous records, the trail. For that, you will be getting the audit trail. You will be getting, because there might be the changes that might happen. So we know what happens in the behind scene. So, you know, so these things needs to be reported by the auditor. You see the onerous position, the responsibility, the enormous amount of, you know, professional responsibility that we need to shoulder upon now. I believe that later on, only the invariable question that will come up is the fees part. But again, that is not the matter to be discussed here right now. Let me just complete this part first. Repayment of investment guarantees, security and loans granted by the company. Friends, actually, out of 21 clauses, in 10 clauses, we find that the CARO has been same as it was there in 10 number of clauses. Now, in repayment of investments, guarantees, securities, and loans granted by the company, previously, it was only for that section 189 disclosure. That is the related party one. You see now what they have done, that investments provided, investments or any guarantee or security or loans or advances provided in the nature of loan, secured, unsecured, provided by the company to any other company, firms or LLPs or partnership or any other parties, whether during, so this is not only the section 189 one, the entire thing. Whether during the year the company has provided loans and the aggregate amount during the year and the balance outstanding at the balance sheet date with respect to such loans or advances and guarantees or securities, and the aggregate amount of during the year and the balance outstanding with respect of loans and advances availed. So all these and investments, in case of investments made or guarantees provided, securities given, so there also the entire details, which is not prejudicial to the interest of the company, that needs to be judged in respect of loans. You see, in respect of loans, whether the schedule of the repayment of the principal and payment of the interest has been stipulated and whether the repayment or receipts are regular. If the amount is overdue, state the total amount overdue for more than 90 days and whether reasonable steps have been taken by the company for recovery of principal and interest. So what steps the company has taken? Everything needs to be written here. Whether any loan or advances in the nature of the loan has been renewed or extended, or the fresh loan has been granted to settle the overdue of the existing loan, you need to mention the aggregate amount of such dues renewed and or extended, and the percentage of aggregate to the total loans or advances in the loans of granted. The percentage means the how much percentage of the loans has been extended or you know, granted freshly. So this is, again, don't you think that this is something almost like a management report? This is a change that has been brought in this CARO. Now, another change is acceptance of compliance of section 185 and 186, the same provision remains. That is, whether they have been complied or not. Acceptance of deposits. Previously, the company has accepted the deposits in terms or in accordance to the directive issued by RBI and in accordance to section 73 and 76 of the 73 to 76 of the Companies Act, wherever applicable. But now the deposits accepted by the company or amounts which are deemed to be deposit, whether the directives issued by the RBI or any other relevant provisions like 73 and 76 applicable have been complied with, if not the nature of such contravention. So cost records is similar with previously what it was there. In case of statutory dues also, the statutory dues only changes, otherwise everything is same. The only change is the, instead of service tax, now GST has been mentioned there. Then your section 177, I'm just skipping some of the provisions. They're actually internal audit system. Now it needs to be reflected. Previously, there was no such mentioning was there. It was there in the earlier CARU. Now, whether the company has an internal audit system commensurate with the size and nature of the business, that needs to be mentioned. Whether the reports of the internal auditors for the period under audit were considered by the statutory auditor, that needs to be reported. And cash losses, whether the company has incurred cash losses in the financial year and in immediately preceding financial year, that needs to be again reported. Now, this cash loss means your PBT. Your PBT needs to be added with the depreciation and amortizations. That comes, that gives you the cash loss. That needs to be reflected. There was no such provision in the previous CARU. This is again something which is a little, you know, surprising to note. Here it has been mentioned whether there has been, this is point number, clause number 18, whether there has been any resignation of the statutory auditors during the year. If so, whether the auditor has taken into consideration the issues, the objections, or the concerns raised by the outgoing auditors. So we have SA 210 that is clearly that mentions about what needs to be done or what should be done by the incoming auditor. We have to consider the concern raised by the previous auditor. So why this has been again mentioned here, and particularly about this, whether there has been any resignation of the statutory auditors during the year, this provision was not there in the last CARU. So now this needs to be reflected. In fact, just to take a little, you know, deviation from this discussion, there is a specific, I just want to add here, there is a specific press note that is there web hosted in the MCA portal, where MCA for the first time has explained what is to be done, or whether in case of proprietorship concern, proprietorship concern means proprietorship auditor, whether the rotation, how the rotation will be affecting to the proprietorship auditor, and whether this is for only one single term of 5 years, then the auditor needs to be mandatorily changed or rotated. So these things are given in that particular press note, although this is strictly not related to our discussion that we are having today. But this is also something which is a matter of concern, because what we are finding nowadays, there are plenty of changes that are happening in the, you know, the auditors, for which unjustified removals are taking place. So that is something we can discuss in a different forum, different you know, day, on a different day. But this has been also there. Now, another thing is, this is also very, very important. That is clause number your 19. On the basis of the financial ratios that needs to be reflected in the notes that we have already learned. On the basis of the financial ratios, aging also we are getting, aging and expected dates of realization of the financial assets and payment of financial liabilities, the auditor's knowledge of the board of directors and management plans, whether the auditor is of the opinion, you see this, the auditor needs to provide, needs to share his opinion that no material uncertainty exists as on the date of the audit report that the company is capable of meeting its liabilities existing at the date of the balance sheet, as and when they fall due within a period of 1 year from the date of the balance sheet. You see this from the date, from considering the accounting ratios and considering all other things, the aging and these things, you need to comment on the financial soundness of the company for the next 1 year. You need to consider, you need to comment whether they fall due within a period of 1 year from the balance sheet, whether the company is capable of meeting its liabilities or not. So you think the stretch, you think the width of your responsibility, the shoulder that you need to carry is really, it needs to be very strong and firm. Now, again, I'm just skipping. This is, I believe it's 12:55. So can I just continue for 2-3 minutes more, organizer? Can you hear me? Hello? Okay. Yeah. So now about the ongoing projects of the CSR, that also needs to be reflected in the in this particular CARO thing. Managerial remuneration, no provision is there, although this managerial remuneration used to be reflected in the previous CARO. Reasons to be stated for unfavorable comment, whether in the auditor's reports, the answer to any of the questions is unfavorable or qualified, the auditor's report shall also state the reasons for unfavorable one. So more or less, CARO, I have just completed very quickly due to paucity of time. So with this note, I take the opportunity to conclude this session. And this is something where actually we need to carry a really a very onerous job in days to come. So with this, let me conclude. Thank you so very much for giving this opportunity to share my thoughts, and thank you all to give me for giving me the patient hearing. Thanks to all. Over to organizers.
Thank you, Animesh, for a wonderful deliberation. Divan is going to organize this question answer session. He will be organizing the questions that has been asked for your benefit. The only thing I would like to say here, Animesh, that as you are surprised with the number of companies that have increased, the registration of number of companies that have increased. Similarly, we are also surprised with the Sensex actually, because the Sensex has been very shooting up and up and up, and now it is 52,000 actually.
Right.
So also been quite surprising. I think people are predicting better things in the future, maybe after the pandemic. And that is why Sensex is shooting up. At the same time, I think they are also predicting better times in the future. That is why they want to enter when the when
can't hear Sumantra, I can't hear you.
আনমিউট করে নাও।
Sumantra, please unmute.
Sir, there are a lot of connectivity issues today. Now you can hear me, na? Yes, I've unmuted. sorry, yes. So the question is, there are a lot of, and the second thing also I would like to ask, I think it has not been asked in the chat box, that for smaller companies, because every company now has to maintain an audit trail, so on and so forth. But for smaller companies, which prepares its books of accounts on a single sitting, I mean, after the end of the financial year, what will happen to them and how the auditors will be doing justice to their audit?
Connectivity problem is there.
Animesh sir,
yes.
Let's do one thing. Let's move to the questions that we have received in the chat box.
Can you just help me out, please?
Yes. I'll do that.
Yeah.
I'll do that. Just a moment.
Acha, just taking the cue of Sumantroda. This is just. Let me clear this thing. Point is really yeah. It is a matter of concern that every day we are finding the Sensex is rising. Probably this is due to the fact that more retail investors are now in the game. So the corpus or the total stretch of the retail market is expanding every day. This has happened due to the fact that more alternative source of making earning is there from the market. People at least are thinking that. And secondly, there is no major correction is there in the market on and often. That is a normal theory, or this is a normal trend of the market, but no major correction in that way has happened till since the lockdown started, or since the pandemic started. So that is one thing. And second, what Sumantrada has very correctly mentioned, that what would happen for the micro small companies where this keeping the audit trail, preparing the board's report, the so much of the compliances. So all these things are, pretty tough to handle.
That is applicable for every company. That is
applicable for all. No threshold limit, for nothing all. Has been set.
Yes.
So this is really a matter of concern. But at the same time, I think the view of the regulator is like, if you really want to run a company, run like a company only. It should not be a partnership firm only, or a proprietorship one, only one single individual running a company. So
that is
there.
Anyway, Devan has the questions ready. Devan, if you kindly take over with the questions now.
Yes.
Questions.
So I have also shared it on the screen after copying all the questions from the chat box. So all can also see the questions. So the first question is, can the MCA e-scrutinize the returns which were filed earlier, or it will be from this financial year?
See, nothing is mentioned in that way, since the scrutiny is now going to start. So possibility is that the henceforth it will be covered, but as such no clarity is there.
The next question, is it possible to cancel an e-form which is filed with ROC or MCA, whether approved or not?
See, cancellation of e-form which has been filed earlier, it can be done, but for that an affidavit needs to be filed why this needs to be cancelled, and that reason needs to be stated by the company only, not by the professional. It needs to carry an affidavit, and that needs to be submitted with the jurisdictional ROC, and on the basis of that only the ROC can cancel the previously filed form. But for that a definite and very you know, justified reason needs to be shown. It's not like that, because what we have seen in many of the cases, this is something which is really unfortunate, and that have happened from a professional only, that he has used the signature, the digital signature, and filed, uploaded the form with the attachments of another company. So definitely the work has been done by his junior or article. These things are really, you know, not acceptable. So, but these are all happening. So that can be done, but this is a long drawn process, and you need to be very careful once you submit this application.
So a company has neither deposits nor exempted deposits as on 31st March 21.
No need of. DPT-3 is not required to be filed if the deposit is not there. But, you know, sometimes it is told that for the sake of, you know, clarity, for the sake of brevity, you can keep on filing. But the suggestion is better you can avoid. I mean, there is no requirement. There is no direction in this regard. Only thing is, if you file, you can at least raise a bill.
Can an individual be appointed as CFO and CS in a quoted company?
This I need to check. This I need to check, because this is a divided opinion. Yes, this is very true. This is a divided opinion. Good question. Can an individual be appointed as CFO and CS in a quoted company? I need to check. I need to check it, and I'll come back with this. Devayan, please keep a note on this.
Okay.
If I skip any question, or if I you know, face these sort of things, please keep a note. I'll come back to you later.
I'll share it with you.
Yeah.
In the Companies Act 1956 regime, DCA had issued various circulars and clarifications. Are those valid in today's era?
Sir, this, if these are still valid, then you are actually considering the 1956 Act as alive. So how can it be? Now it is 2013 Act, so the circulars and clarifications are all as per the 2013 Act only.
The next one is a request. Sir, please repeat the CSR amendments once again by giving example for more clarity if possible.
I think I can share you with the, because this will again take a long time. So it is better if we can share this PPT. And as well as there is one write-up on this particular CSR with me, from where actually I have considered, I'll share that with you also for sharing with the members.
Okay. Can the date of signing of the audit report and financial statements be different from that of the signing date by the board of directors?
Yeah, this is something which is a long-drawn, intriguing question. Sumantrada, do you want to highlight, or do you want to keep light on this?
I don't want to comment. See, because unofficially the audit gets over earlier, and then the board passes the unaudited accounts, and the auditors then put their signature because they have actually audited. But I think ideally there should be some time gap between the board signing the accounts and the auditors then signing. Ideally,
here the question is, can the date of signing of the audit report is a bit different from that of the signing date of the board of directors? So generally what happens,
it can be a later date, it can be a later date, obviously.
What we generally do as a convention, that actually, the method is like this, that is, on the day of the board meeting, when the accounts will be passed by the board, the auditor submits or the places the audit report along with the audited accounts. So there actually the directors as well as the auditor signs. That's a convention.
Yes.
What the question is raising, or the question is telling us here, that if the, what I have understood from here, correct me if I'm wrong, that the accounts date is given as, say, 4th of May. And you are signing as an auditor and putting another date as 6th of June. So is it allowed? See, actually, that this is actually not possible in the sense that this report that finally is going to the stakeholders is a final approved report signed by the auditor, approved by the board. So after submission of the audit report by the auditor and approval by the board, no further directors meeting will be held for approving that particular financial statement before the AGM. So after that, only AGM will be held. So naturally, these two dates will coincide and only one single date present remains present. Next question. Is the Tally ERP version suitable to comply
with
the...
No. That is not the next question.
Oh, acha, acha.
Mr. Right. A and Mr. B are the only directors in a company.
Acha.
Mr. A is a foreign national. He attended the board meeting for accounts approval from Singapore. And Mr. B attended sitting in India via video conferencing. So what will be the place of signing on the face of the balance sheet?
Where the auditor is sitting. Definitely in India. And the registered office is situated in India. Now here, one thing, first thing is this, that this is now allowed due to pandemic. This is now allowed. Now, since the foreign national has signed this accounts sitting in, abroad, he can put his place there. He's signing from, say, US, he can put his place there. But finally, the auditor's signature and the other director's signature will carry the date of India. Next is Tally ERP version suitable to comply. No, Tally ERP version is not suitable for your audit trail thing. There the audit feature is given, but that audit feature will not, serve the purpose of what actually is required as per the act or as per the amendment act. For that, you need to go for Tally Prime. That is a different version.
I think they have come out
yes, with that. Yes, they have come out with that. They have come out with that. And also, I believe that some discounts are offered to chartered accountants for having this. In CARO, the auditor has to comment if undisputed statutory dues are paid regularly. Does this clause also include advance income tax? The auditor has to comment if undisputed statutory dues are paid regularly. See, actually, advance tax is not actually in that way required to be mentioned in this particular part. Only thing is the statutory dues, if that statutory dues like your advance income tax that gets, delayed or something like that, then only the question or the comment will come. Can you give an example of a dividend which has been declared was not paid to members due to operation of law? Can you give an example where dividend which has been declared was not paid to members due to operation of law, which has been declared, was not paid to members due to operation of law. I'm not clear about what exactly.
Now, if the person can unmute himself and ask the question directly.
Yes, please.
The person who has asked this question, if at all. There is that person.
Can you give an example where dividend which has been declared was not paid to members due to operation of law?
Mr. Mojumdar, if you can unmute yourself and clarify the question.
Devan, thank you, learned organizer.
Can I clarify this question?
Yeah.
He's clarifying. Let
me give you an example that the dividend has been declared in June 2021.
Acha, dividend is declared on June 21.
Court case has been instituted in July 2021.
What case?
Prohibiting the distribution of dividend. The question says that where dividend has been declared but could not be paid to members due to operation of law. This is one of the examples which suggests in case because of operation of any court of law's order or any operational legal issues, the dividend cannot be paid. That has to be narrated in the balance sheet. This is my opinion.
See, actually, yeah.
Mr. Mojumdar, if you...
Devan.
Clarify the question, yes.
Yeah, Devan, actually, my question was with reference to section 127. There are certain cases where the company and its directors and officers will not be liable to penalty under certain circumstances. And one of the clause therein is that if the failure to make the payment is due to operation of law.
Right. Due to you mean to say due to operation of law, the dividend could not be paid?
Yeah, I just wanted to have an example from you. I mean, in the practical.
I think Gautam sir has rightly cited one.
Because of the fact that
Let me ask one question. There are two issues relating to operation of law. One, generally, the words operation of law means commencement or implementation of a new law prohibiting distribution of dividend. Such laws have not come in India till now.
Right.
But the other interpretation of operation of law means that if there is a litigation, suppose between the company and some of the shareholders, and the shareholders went to the court and obtained an injunction that the dividend cannot be distributed to any of the shareholders, then what happens?
No, but Animesh, one thing. Suppose if CBI or ED attaches the property of the company, and then the payment of dividend also automatically gets stopped, isn't it? I mean, I also want to add to Gautam's question.
Yes. CBI and ED, they have got power to confiscate dividend, right to receive dividend also.
Okay.
Right to receive dividend is an actionable claim. And is definitely confiscated.
So that is also operation of law.
That is not known as operation of law.
Implementation of law.
Operation of order.
Order. Achha.
There is a difference between operation of law and operation of order.
Correct. I understand. Okay, Chonimesh, follow. Mute. Animesh, you are muted.
Right. Is it okay now?
Okay.
Yes.
Now, what is the duty of the... Etai to chilo? If the auditor... No, eta to abar alada hoye gelo.
New question, what is the duty of statutory auditor of a private limited company if the auditee does not provide liability for leave encashment on actuarial basis as per AS 50? Number of employees are 25.
Yeah, so statutory auditor, if he doesn't comply anything, any accounting standard, which is required to be followed, which is mandatorily required to be followed, then definitely this is a deviation that has been done by the statutory auditor.
Correct.
So basically, it is the duty of the statutory auditor.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Company A has invested in Company B by way of unsecured debentures. Company A has invested in Company B by way of unsecured debentures. Will it be deposits in the hands of B, or will it be exempted deposit as it is a case of amount received by a company from another company? That I need to check the deposit coverage first. Let us go to another question first, then I'm just noting it. I'll be coming back to this. Is provision for doubtful debts written back to be considered for determining the threshold for turnover criteria of 20 crore for small companies? No. Will you discuss what is mean by cryptocurrencies? Cryptocurrencies is something, it follows the blockchain system, and they are actually a software puzzle is given, and that puzzle needs to be This is it's a back-end data mining thing which actually solves a puzzle. So this is something where you can say there is no underlying assets as such. That is the greatest disadvantage or the risk that the cryptocurrencies carry. In case of shares, what we find, there is an underlying assets. But here that cryptocurrency is something devoid of that. Cryptocurrency is completely speculative in nature. Whether a small company is 2 crore paid up capital or turnover 20 crore or 50 crore turnover 20 crore, no. The minimum criteria and the maximum criteria. Now presently what the, after this amendment, now it is a paid up capital 2 crore and the turnover is 20 crore. Anyone, if any either of the two is getting attracted or getting, not complied with, then the company will lose the character or the color of small company. Can a member ask for copies?
So this is applicable for financial year 2021.
This is applicable for financial year this year, 21-22.
22.
Now, can a member ask for copies of minutes of general meetings of a company by email without inspection? Can a member ask for copies of the minutes of the general meeting?
I think so.
Of a company by email without inspection. See, actually, a member can ask for the minutes of the general meeting. This is a difficult proposition. Without inspection. Okay. Without.
So what is the meaning of without inspection? In this
without inspection. I believe that what the member here has wanted to mention, that previously what the system was like this, that the company, if a member wants to have the minutes, copy of the minutes of the general meetings, he can approach to the company and pay for the, photocopies of
certified
the
certified copy.
Yeah, certified copy. And from there only he can get the minutes. Now, the question is, can a member ask for copies of the minutes of the general meeting of a company by email without inspecting? I think there is no circular or no direction is given in this regard, but this is something which is
good question.
Good question.
It's a very peculiar question.
This is
no, because normally in any case, approving the minutes of last year's AGM is never in the items of business. But as a matter of abundant precaution, many companies also distribute the minutes of the last AGM. Right. I think that is what the law says. But whether a member separately can get that is a good question, actually.
Can a member, let me just think it.
No, someone has said you can apply through RTI, but I don't think it is a public authority.
No.
Company is not
That is not the thing.
The member can definitely have the ask for the copies of the minutes.
I am thinking in a different way, that for this particular provision or this particular direction, I mean, nothing as such has come up anywhere in the circular or in the notes or in the many things can be done by convention. Many things can be done out of the interpretations.
1 minute.
But, yeah.
Right of inspection and right of obtaining copies are two different and distinct rights. So if he doesn't exert the right of inspection, it does not preclude him from obtaining right of copies. So he can definitely get the right copies. Whether by email or by hard copies is a different thing. But
no, what Onimus Gautamda is trying to say is whether the company can stop that member from getting the copies.
The company can stop.
Right. The point is, since there is no specific direction in this regard, company has the liberty to stop this.
Yes.
If the company keeps its accounts manually, is it compulsory to introduce the software with an audit trail? See, actually, if you have it is clearly mentioned in that particular, the rules, that the company which is maintaining its account in the software mode, in the virtual mode, or rather electronically, only in those cases the audit trail is required to be maintained. In case if it is maintained manually, no need of the question of audit trail comes. I mean, that is not required. So these are the things, but Devayan, please share the, you know, unanswered questions. Only one thing. unsecured debentures, that question, please go to that question, Devayan. Company has invested in company B by way of unsecured debentures. Will it be deposited in the hands of B or will it be exempted? See, unsecured debentures is not a dispute. Unsecured debenture is not a deposit if it is compulsorily convertible within 10 years. So this can be considered then. Unsecured debenture is not a deposit if it is compulsorily convertible within 10 years. So that's the thing. So we need to see the nature of this debenture first. Okay.
Onimesh, there are two more questions. How do we judge the promoter for disclosure of promoter shareholding?
How do we judge the promoter for disclosure of promoter's shareholding?
To unmute korte bolo unake je question. Who has asked this question? If he is kindly unmute him so that.
Mr. Nirmal Chakraborty.
Hello. Hello.
Yes. Yeah, Mr. Chakraborty. Yeah, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Actually, I want to know how we judge the promoters, as there is the new era of changing in this Companies Act, and for the disclosure purpose, the shareholding, right. Promoter shareholding is separately disclosed here.
Right.
But generally, who is the promoter, where from we can judge whether he is a promoter or not? There may be some people. Who are the promoter, who promotes the company at the time, its name mentioned in this article of association or something like
Mr.
that.
Mr. Chakraborty, yes. You please consider section 2, subsection 69.
Okay.
There the definition of promoter is given. I am just, for the sake of discussion, I am just considering this. Promoter means a person who has been named as such in the prospectus or is identified by the company in the annual return, or who has control over the affairs of the company directly or indirectly, whether as a shareholder, director, or otherwise, or in accordance with whose advice, directions, or instructions the board of directors is accustomed to act, provided that nothing in subclause C, that is the last one, shall apply to a person who is acting merely in a professional capacity. So basically, a person who has been named as promoter by the company will be considered as promoter.
Sir, we have to consider who has signed this annual return, he should be the promoter, I think.
Not always that. I mean, a person like what we generally do, whose names are appearing in the MOA, generally they are considered as promoters, provided they are still there in the company. And in case by whose directions the company actually acts. Now, at times it might happen that the main promoter is not there. It is not necessary that everybody will sign to the balance sheets or everybody will sign to the financial statements. So any two numbers can suffice. I mean, so the two directors can be the non-promoter persons also. So in that way, you cannot come to the conclusion.
Sir, are you saying this beneficial ownership concept?
Beneficial ownership is again a different one. Beneficial ownership is again a different one. But what I try to mean you is that the promoter will be decided by the company itself. It's not that it will be decided on convention or something like that. It actually gets decided by the, because as per the definition, you see, who has been named as such in the prospector or is identified by the company in the annual return, he is regarded as a promoter. So it has clearly mentioned in the act. Acha.
Okay, not always who has signed this annual return, promoter.
No.
Suppose the name in this MOA is different person, but actually the annual return is a different person has signed, that then both are called the promoter.
Might be. This is a different person. Promoter, it is not necessary that always the promoter will sign the annual return. That's what actually I tried to mean. It might be any director. Any two directors can sign. If a company has CC limit of 2 crores, but utilize only 50 lakhs during the during any time of the previous year, will Karo 2020 see, actually, if the company has CC limit of 2 crores, but utilized only. Yes, this is very important. Now, the point is, what is the total? What is the loan? Any point of time, if it has used that 2 crore thing, then definitely it will be this thing. But throughout the year, it's not that at the end of the year only, or the balance would be 2 crore, or for a considerable stage. Any point of time, if it crosses that limit, if it touches that limit, then only the Karo will be applicable. But here in the question, it has been stated that it has utilized only 50 lakhs during any time of the previous year. It means otherwise that throughout the year, has it utilized 50 lakhs or
any yes, one yes, point? Yes, maximum utilized during the year was 50 lakhs, I think. That is the question.
So maximum credit that has been utilized during the year is 50 lakhs. So what is the criteria for your Karo, this thing, for whom the Karo is applicable? The Karo is applicable if you're having a paid up capital 1 crore, total borrowing exceeding 1 crore from any bank or financial institution at any point of time during the financial year. Now the question is, 2 crore is a CC limit. So naturally, this is something which is the 50 lakhs has been utilized. So 50 lakhs is the amount of the loan that has been availed by the company for the entire period. So if that is so, then naturally your total borrowing has not gone more than 1 crore.
Right.
You cannot say it is a borrowing. Once the CC limit is given, we don't consider the company has borrowed 1 crore. Isn't it?
Only the funded part
two crore,
is...
Sorry, 2 crore. That's... Yeah, only the funding. Only the fund-based thing. Please discuss about the chronology of signing accounts and audit report that we have already discussed. But again, to recapitulate, initially signing first by the directors, then the auditors.
Anuvesh Babu, may I just... Hello, Anuvesh Babu.
Yes, yes.
May I just give you the chronology? Please tell me if I am wrong. First of all, the draft account is prepared and it is placed before the board meeting. The board approves. Then it goes to the auditor for audit. Auditor completes the audit and another board meeting is called where the auditor signs the account, signs the accounts and the auditor's report. Because in the auditors, in the accounts, you will find we write in terms of our report of event date attached. So that is the board meeting for accepting the audited accounts and calling an AGM. Because unless the audit report is received, the board cannot write the board report, which has right. to be placed in the AGM. Am I right? Because this yes, is the... Yes.
Any dispute that coming to your mind?
No, actually, in the last discussion, what I understood, that there is one board meeting and after the auditor signs, there is no further board meeting. But no, there no, no. can be...
That is the last board meeting I told. Before the AGM.
Okay.
Before the AGM, that is the last board meeting by convention. Otherwise, yes, definitely board, I cannot or nobody can restrain the board to hold the meeting. But for the sake of passing the financial statements, that is supposed to be the last board meeting.
Okay.
So there are two meetings actually.
Yes,
there might be more than two meetings in this particular financial statements.
But at least two meetings.
At least two meetings should be there.
Yes. Devashish, you have to take a check.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So,
there are no more questions. So, these are the ones.
Yeah, please send me that. I'll definitely take a note of this and I'll come back to you shortly. তুমি আমাকে একটু মেইল করে দিও দেবাইন
yes yes I'll do that
খুব ভালো সেশন খুব থ্রেডবেয়ার ডিসকাশন হলো
নো বাট সিন্স মানে চেঞ্জেস আর সো ভেরি লার্জ
তো yes yes and scattered also scattered
also but I think ওই একটা কারো এবং
শিডিউল 3 আর কারো শিডিউল 3 এন্ড কারো আর দা টু মোস্ট ইম্পর্ট্যান্ট
মোর ইন্ট্রিকেসিস ক্যান বি কভারড देयर
কভারড यस
But definitely, you know, Sunday lunch and skipping all this, the questions that are coming up really.
People are very, very interested. Yeah, well,
this is something really.
Lot
really
of interest.
Notable. Thank you so much. Thank you for providing me this opportunity.
Right. Rajat Shubhra, what did you ask? What did you say?
Rajat, where are
you? I don't know. What is the question? Rajat, you have to unmute your question. Ta kore dao, tappar Devan. হ্যান্ডকে দিচ্ছি তারপর সুমন দেবে ভোটার থ্যাংকস কোথায় রজতের কোয়েশ্চেনটা
কোয়েশ্চেনটা হচ্ছে ইন কেস অফ স্মল কোম্পানিজ অনলি টু বোর্ড মিটিংস মে বি সাফিসিয়েন্ট
হ্যাঁ তাই হয়েছে রজত দা এখন বাট দ্যাট ইজ ফর দিস টু কোয়ার্টার্স অনলি আপ টু সেপ্টেম্বর বিকজ দ্য গ্যাপ ইজ নাও 180 ডেজ সো ন্যাচারালি দ্যাট মিন্স অনলি টু মিটিংস ইন 6 মান্থস So, but this is applicable only till 30th of September 2021. Ekhon jodi tar pore abar third wave eshe jay, then this will be only one meeting, only one meeting in a year. But anyways, so
that very good, very good. Okay, Devan, you kindly take over, and Sumon is also there. Yes.
So, we started a bit late. So, on a Sunday morning, people poured in. A bit slowly, and that also gave us a scope for some informal discussions in the beginning. And then we had a wonderful session for the last 2 hours, 15 minutes. And Animesda had taken us through all the important new changes that has taken place in the Corporate Act. And there were quite a few questions. Most of them have been answered and discussed thoroughly. I think it was a great session. And there are 3-4 requests and questions which have been mailed to the speaker, which he has assured us that he would be addressing to. And once he does that, I would be sharing it with all of you. So,
I think. And we also regularly, Devan, we regularly send it to the delegates. We send the YouTube video also. Na? We normally. Right. We send the YouTube video.
Yes,
it's
yes.
uploaded on YouTube. So one can go through also leisurely. Yeah.
Right. Yes. So I would request C.A. Suman Choudhury to kindly offer the formal vote of thanks.
Suman, kotha hai? Suman?
Thank
you, Animesda, for the lovely session. It was for me, I say that we need more of the session in future. That will be covering all the relevant topics of the amendments to the Companies Act and CARO and all other relevant issues that might come up in your future. It was a fantastic deliberation given by Onivesa today. It's a Sunday afternoon now, but we feel that we can continue for more of such hours. And it's a very engrossing session. And I would like to thank you on behalf of our study circle on behalf of Sumon Proda, Shantanuda, Deban, Sumon, and everybody of us. And we look forward to more of such sessions from you on this matter in future. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, Animesda. And thank you, all the delegates.
So let us unmute and give a thunderous applause to Animes. Let us unmute
you.
And give a thunderous
applause. Thank you. And thanks to the young brigade also. The young brigade.
Yes.
Young brigade with the experienced mind that I am finding here. So thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Animesda. Thank you.
So we are leaving the program. Yes.
Right. Thank you. Yeah.